Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to actually read Ephesians 1:1-14. Here we go. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. So praise God. The Apostle Paul, he writes this letter to the church of Ephesus. You know, we also have commentary from the Lord himself in the book of Revelation. And whenever he's talking about, which we just studied the other night, when he's talking about the churches, and he has a message for Ephesus, for the church of the Ephesians. Actually, that's the first church that Jesus, he addresses in the church age time frame of the book of Revelation. And what he says to the church of the Ephesians is that he commends them, meaning he has a good word to say to them, is that they tested the prophets. In other words, they put to the test those who said that they were prophets to make sure that what they were speaking was the truth. One of the things that we've learned as we've studied the New Testament in detail is that from the beginning or the inception of the church age, that the enemy has used false doctrine and false prophets to creep into the church to bring deception and to cause destruction in the body of Christ, to thwart the plan of God, to prevent God's plan from going forward. So Jesus' commendation for the church of Ephesus is that, hey, you did a great job in that. You held them accountable. You listened closely to what they said, and you made sure that what you were hearing was the truth. But I got this one thing against you. You've left your first love. And we all would know that, even in our personal lives, that that's a risk that all of us run. There's been times you can remember back when you first gave your heart to the Lord, and you felt the joy of the Lord, or maybe even it wasn't when you first gave your heart to the Lord. Maybe it was at some point in time in your walk with God that he did something to your heart and he just made you exuberant. He made you filled with abundant joy about the things of God. You couldn't get enough of the word of God. You wanted to talk about Jesus. Amen. It wasn't that you necessarily wanted to preach to someone. I know that there was a time not to call her out, but my mama thought that. I mean, when the Lord got a hold of me after some things that happened in my life, man, I was just so excited for Jesus. And I remember one time, you're not that way anymore, Mom. You love the Lord. Sometimes she'll send me scriptures on my phone. And so, you know, that's not what it is now. But back then, she just didn't understand. And I can remember one time she was at the house, and it wasn't just her, but my older sister too, who loved the Lord and who taught me much about the Bible. They got the impression that I was preaching at them. Maybe it was my personality. Maybe it was me and I was coming across wrong. But what I felt was I was just excited about Jesus, and I felt like I had to tell somebody about the things that I was learning, right? And, you know, the response was is that you know, you don't need to preach at me or you don't need to preach to me. Ain't nobody's preaching. I'm just talking. I'm talking about Jesus. And you know what I'm talking about. Whenever the Lord did a work in your heart and you were excited about God, you wanted to just give Him praise. That's what I titled my message this morning, Give Him Praise. Amen. One of the first things that I want to look at, if you could put Ephesians 1:3 up on the screen. But before we even get there, you know, so the Apostle Paul writes the letter to the Ephesians while he's in prison. It is one of the prison epistles. But one of the things that I want to talk to you about, just a little teaching comment about these letters. And we've mentioned it before, but I want to mention it again. These letters serve, in a sense, as commentary on the Gospels. Well, what do you mean? Well, whenever the Gospels came and we read the words of Jesus and the teachings of Jesus, we see where his teachings even confounded the wise. You remember the stories about the Pharisees, and they didn't understand, and even many of the lay folk that would listen to Jesus teach, they would say, there was one scripture that I'll never forget in the Old Testament, not in the Old Testament, in one of the Gospels, where they said, where does this man have no letters? And the word in the Greek is gramma, and it means, where does he have the understanding of these words? Where did he gain this knowledge that he did not have, an education? He didn't go to the school of the rabbis. Where does he learn letters? Where does he get this from? His doctrine confounded them. It confused them. He was giving them revelation that they just didn't know previously. And to be truthful, for you and I who live in the new covenant, if we just had the Gospels by themselves, we would feel much like those people did that were coming out of the Old Testament. Why? Because Jesus didn't explain in intricate detail exactly what his words meant. For instance, he says in one of the scriptures, and I just wrote some of this down this morning, he said in one of the scriptures, he said, I've given you power to tread on scorpions and serpents. Now, when you begin to read the context of what he's talking about there, you begin to realize he's talking about power over demonic forces, power over the enemy. Whether or not in the spiritual realm they look like scorpions or serpents, I don't really know. That's not what I'm trying. But what I am saying is that's what Jesus was talking about. He was talking about demonic forces. Now, for you and I, there was also one that I use oftentimes, Matthew 12, where he cast the devil out, and he talks about you can't take the spoil of a man's house till you first bind the strong man. What Jesus was talking about was that he came to earth to bind the strong man, which is Satan, so that the people of God can gain the victory for God through the power of the Holy Spirit. So when you take those two concepts together, what we realize that what Jesus was talking about is that he came to give a transference of power from the heavenly realm to believers so that we could walk in the victory that God had planned for us. Amen. But had we not had the writings of the Apostle Paul and some of the other writers, it would have been a little bit more difficult for us to understand exactly what he was saying. Amen. He also made a comment. He said, you can't put new wine in old wineskins. What he was talking about was a transition from the old covenant to the new covenant. He said, you can't sew a new patch on an old garment. Or an old patch on a new garment, because if you did either one, the old couldn't contain the new. You can't try to function in the new the way that they function in the old. That's why works-based Christianity doesn't work. In other words, whenever you attempt through your own works and efforts to gain a right place in standing with God, it's a works-based Christianity. The Old Testament law was built upon the works of the Christian, even and all that he did. That wasn't what was supposed to make him righteous, but the Old Testament was filled with works, and in their mind, they thought that that's what made them righteous. It doesn't work that way. It's very important for us to understand in Christianity that Jesus is the righteous one, and that there's a transference that takes place. So the new wine, if you put it in an old wineskin as it would ferment, the brittle wineskin couldn't tolerate it and it would burst. And if you put an old patch on a new garment, when you wash the garment and it dries, it shrinks and it makes the tear worse than what it was before. The old can't contain the new. You can't function that way according to the old ways, right? And also he talked to the disciples even in the Sermon on the Mount about the fact that you are the light of the world. Without the letters and the commentaries of the letters that were written by the apostles, it would be difficult for us to really understand what Jesus meant by that. What does it mean that you are the light of the world? But within that framework, and I'm just trying to use this as an example to, so you can understand the importance of these letters, within that framework, we're given greater illumination, greater understanding on the words of the Lord Himself. And so that's what we gain out of these letters. And let's go back to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, and let's just kind of start digging in and see what it is that the Apostle Paul is telling the church of Ephesus. He says, "According as He has chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love." So the word "according" is actually reaching back to Ephesians 1, 2. And if you want to go to that right now, you can. But the word "according" right here is referring to the previous verse, which refers to spiritual blessing that are awaiting those that have been chosen. But before we consider the thought of chosen, let's consider some of the thoughts surrounding these spiritual blessings. All right, let's go ahead and look. It says, "Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." I think it must be in verse 2. "Blessed be the God and Father." And I want you to pay attention to that "blessed be the God and Father," because we're going to come to that at the end of the sermon. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings and heavenly places." Now, the first thing that I want to point out to you is that these blessings are spiritual in nature. And one of the things that I want you to understand is that whenever you gain any type of blessing from God, and really all blessings are spiritual, and I'm not trying to confine these blessings, because guess what? All blessings from God are spiritual in a sense. But I do believe that these blessings that we're talking about right here, they have a direct context having to do with the spiritual realm. But what I want you to know is this, is that God the Holy Spirit is the one that gives the blessing to the believer. Amen. I know I've tried to explain this before, but I think that it's important that you and I understand that. That God the Holy Spirit is the one that dispenses the blessing to the believer. In other words, if you receive a blessing from God, if you receive a spiritual blessing from God, it's coming to you by way of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So they're given by, and another thing that I want you to understand is that these blessings are contained in the heavenly realm in Christ Jesus. So the blessings are spiritual. They're in the heavenly realm. They're in Christ. And you know, Brother Swagger and them say oftentimes that Jesus is the source and that the Holy Spirit is the means. Amen. And one of the things that I was thinking of as I was considering that concept is trying to, you know, help people to see it a little bit better. At first, what I did was I drew almost like a tank. And the first time I did it, it was like that. And I said, well, you know, nothing that God does is half full, right? So I had to redraw it in my mind. And so what I did was I put it up to the top. But the reality of it is that it'd really be overflowing. God's blessings are an overabundance, amen. And He wants them to spill over into our lives. But for the purpose of the analogy of what I'm trying to say is this, is that here you are as the believer and you're the recipient of something. You receive from God spiritual blessings. Yes. Amen? Well, what I want you to know is that this is the source. This is where it all comes from. This represents Jesus. He came to do a work upon the earth, to do the work of the Father in order for these spiritual blessings to be able to be given unto you. But the way that they do it is they're given to you through the person of the Holy Spirit. He is the conduit that allows these blessings to flow from the heavenly realm into the earthly realm where they come from God into you. All I'm trying to tell you this morning is that the Holy Spirit is the one who dispenses the blessings of God, who dispenses the work of God in the midst of your life. But He does it based upon what Jesus has already accomplished when He died on the cross at Calvary. I used to say this a lot when I first started teaching and I was gaining understanding of the importance of the cross. This is why you can't let people tell you that we have to move past the cross. I'm not trying to pick on anybody, but there was a guy named Kenneth Hagin, and he was teaching some things that were wrong, and it really affected a big part of the church. And he talked about the fact that the cross was the greatest defeat of human history. No, sir, you're wrong. That the cross was the greatest victory of human history. Amen. Yeah. Because listen to me, the cross is the pivot point of your Christianity. The cross is the place I don't even really know anybody ever worked with cars before and seen Bondo. I used to know some guys that worked in a body shop. All right. What do you call that stuff that you put in there that actually activates it?
Resin.
It's a resin, but it forms as a catalyst, right? It, a chemical reaction takes place. I don't know if they call it catalyst, but that's what it was. But y'all know what I'm talking about, you guys. You put some kind of, you got this one stuff that looks like putty, and until you put that other stuff in there, it's just going to be putty. You can try to put it in a dent in your car, and if you don't put that other stuff in there, you just walk up there a week later, you reach your hand in there and pull it right out the hole, right? But you squeeze that resin in there, you squeeze that catalyst in there, and you stir it around. You only got so much time. You put it in and it gets hard, almost like cement. But you know, you can sand it off and make it smooth. The point that I'm trying to make is that's what the cross did for humanity. Yes. God had blessings, a plan for blessings that he desired to dispense to you, but until the cross and your faith in that, that's the catalyst. That's the pivot point that allows the change to take place, that allows those spiritual blessings to move from the place where they were in God to the place where they are now in us down here. Spiritual blessings in Christ, hallelujah, that God desires to pour into us through the person of the Holy Spirit. You know, when I think of that, I just think about the goodness and the greatness of God. And I think about the fact that God had this plan from eternity past. I know that I've said this enough times to where surely y'all's minds, I wish I could get in y'all's heads and wonder what y'all think about the Bible. You know, because I know that I say some things so often, and I hope y'all don't get tired of it, but I just try. This is what God's done in my mind, and this is how I think about the Bible. I understand now from multiple scriptures that God knew long before he ever formed Adam out of clay and breathed life into him, long before he even formed this rock we call earth, or at least the way we know it now, that man was going to fall. He knew that man was already going to fall. Peter says it, that you weren't redeemed or bought back with corruptible things such as silver or gold, earthly currency, but instead with the precious blood of the Lamb, which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. God knew in advance that man was going to fall and go the way of the liar, and that he was going to require redemption. God knew before that man was going to be in need of spiritual blessings. Yeah. Amen. And he had a plan in effect in order for those spiritual blessings to be able to move from him into us. Now, you know, this is another thing, and this is very theological, I suppose, but contained within us receiving those spiritual blessings, we see a picture of the Godhead. What I mean by that is a picture of the Trinity. You don't have a problem with the Trinity, hopefully, but you know, there are denominations out there that don't believe in the Trinity. They don't believe in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit being three separate and distinct personalities, but in some way beyond our comprehension, one. Some people would say that, really, I've used an egg before, and you know, somebody corrected me, and they were probably right on that, that it's really more like a marriage, that the two are separate, but in the eyes of God, they come together as one flesh, right? And so the oneness of God. Yet at the same time, three distinct people, persons, three distinct purposes, but one God, one purpose for man. I say purposes, not three distinct purposes, three distinct ways that they deal with man, three distinct functions, but one purpose. Amen. One God, one purpose. Salvation for man, creation of an eternal family. But I'm talking to you about now about getting these spiritual blessings to humanity. And ultimately, what I want you to know is that from the Father's perspective, he knew in advance that man was going to be in need of these spiritual blessings. Amen? And so in his mind, that these spiritual blessings were for all those who would willing to be chosen. That's what he said, chosen in him. That's what the word, we're about to get into chosen here in a second, but chosen in him. That's how God knew in eternity past, this whole plan that he's been methodically working was that I'm going to choose a people in Christ, in my plan, who are going to be reserved for spiritual blessings. Amen? Jesus the Son had purchased the opportunity for anyone who was willing to be chosen. Amen. He purchased it for all. Amen? He purchased it for the Muslim guy that got up in red whenever for the inauguration for the president. He purchased it for the Buddhist over there in China. He purchased it for the Taoist. He purchased it for every last one of them. So God the Father, in his mind in eternity past, had a plan that he was going to give spiritual blessings to all human beings. And Jesus, in his willingness to submit to the Father's will, as at least in his human form, amen, lowered himself, condescended himself to become a servant so that he could die on the cross. And what he did was he purchased that for the entirety of the human race. Praise but the real choosing comes at the level of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That's where the free will of man comes into place. Yeah. And what ends up happening is that when you hear that gospel, see, because the guy that prayed in some Arabic language, they don't even know what he said. They let him just get up there and say it. They don't really, he could have cursed America for all they know. That guy right there, if he refuses to be chosen by the Father the way that the Father chose to choose folks, he's left out.
Amen.
Because when the only way to be chosen is to put faith in the plan of God, which was the sending of the Son of God, which changes your position to a holy God. Amen. This is where the choosing comes into play. It's within the work of the third person, the Holy Spirit. When the person takes their faith and believes the plan set forth, when this happened, the believer is chosen out of the mass of the world. Because of this, some things take place spiritually, amen. One of the words that I wanted you to see is that actually in verse 3, these are some of the things that take place whenever that happens. I want you to think about that. You got this mass of humanity on the face of the globe, and God has a plan to pull them out. I know that we talk about it a lot, but that word chosen goes back to that word that we've talked about before. It's not the exact word, but eklektos. Ek, out. Lektos, chosen. Chosen out. Chosen out of the world. Chosen out of the mass of people that were born of Adam. An Adamic race that was born with sin, that was separated from God. But yet God had a plan to choose out a people for himself. But one of the things in verse 3 that we spoke of, that it says, if you could put verse 3 up there, Ephesians 1 verse 3, is that it says that we're without blame before him. Wasn't that in verse 3?
Yeah.
Is that verse 3?
That's verse 4.
That's verse 4, okay. Without blame before him. You see that right there? That we should be holy and without blame before him in love. That's one of the first things that I just wanted to point out to you this morning about being chosen in him. That what happens whenever you're without blame is that this rushes back to the Old Testament sacrifice. The idea has a blemish connected to it, a spot. What we find ourselves in Christ is that we stand before him. So the word blemish rushes back to the Old Testament sacrifice that had no visible defects, either internally or externally. Many of us, we've talked about this before whenever we studied the Old Testament, the rigorous details that had to take place and the choosing of the sacrifice. They had to be inspected outwardly to make sure there were no obvious scars, no obvious, you couldn't have like a, in other words, well, I was thinking about that Bondo guy whenever I knew them guys in Lafayette, and just popped in my head, they had a three-legged dog over there. You couldn't have a three-legged sacrifice to offer up to the Lord. There couldn't be a visible, but not to get off on a rabbit trail, but that's exactly what the Pharisees were doing in the temple. Remember whenever Jesus turned the tables over? They were selling people at a greater price, defective, according to church tradition and various other scholars. They were selling people defective sacrifices at a higher price than what they were supposed to, and that was the righteous anger that welled up in Jesus. The point being is this, is that God's not going to accept it. He said it in the Old Testament, in the Levitical law, it couldn't have a blemish. There could be no external defect that was obvious. And then they took it a step further and they would cut that animal open and they had to inspect the insides of that animal. They had to look for tumors. They had to look for abnormalities. If there was one kidney missing, they had to throw that one out and they had to start all over from scratch till they found one that, at least according to their inspection, there was no obvious visible defects, whether internally or externally. And what I got to tell you this morning is that Jesus, according to Hebrews 9:14, if you could go there, Jesus is the fulfillment of that. That there was no spot, there was no blemish in him, there was no defect on him. Amen. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14 says this: how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Really, what the author of Hebrews is talking about here is he's trying to convince these Hebrew Christians, listen, Jesus is the fulfillment of a better covenant. Jesus is the fulfillment of God's original plan. You going back to Old Testament sacrifices, you're repeatedly trying to do works that have already been completed. Those Old Testament sacrifices just remind you every year that you're a sinner and that the work is never done. The book of Hebrews says Jesus sat down after he got done working. Those Old Testament high priests, the book of Hebrews said they could never sit down. Why? Because their work was never done. But after he himself offered himself as a sacrifice, and this passage is saying he was one without spot. He was one without blemish. Amen. There was no defect in him. And he offered himself to the Father as a sacrifice for your sin and for my sin. And what Paul's saying is this ought to purge your conscience from a system of dead works. In other words, you don't have to walk around laden or oppressed or burdened by guilt laying on the back of your shoulder. You need to get rid of all of that. The enemy of your soul wants to convince you that you're guilty, but he's a liar and the father of lies. Amen. Jesus took your burden. He took your guilt upon him. Amen. Yes. He was without defect. He was without blemish. He was without spot, both internally and externally. And he offered himself as a sacrifice to the Lord of glory. Hallelujah. And now you, well, let's go ahead and go to Philippians 2:15. See, you were covered. I wrote a word in here, and I know it's not a word, but it describes what I'm trying to say, blemishnessless. He was without blemish. Amen? And now you've been covered with his blemishnessless, and you're presented to God in that fashion. Philippians 2:15, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Amen. I mean, God presents you now because you've been clothed with the righteousness of Christ. It makes you different. We haven't even got to that point yet. We're going to talk about that in a second. It makes you different. And it allows God's light to shine in you and through you. Now, we're not going to get ahead of ourselves. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to be tempted. But I need you to know that that's part of the plan of God. Amen. To use you as a light in the midst of darkness. It's a big part of the plan of God. And any preacher in this town or any other town stands behind a pulpit. Listen, if for some reason I'm not the preacher over here next year or 10 years, and whoever stands behind this pulpit, or you're flipping through channels and you're watching other preachers on television, if they're telling you that part of the plan is not related to you being used by God and being a light in the midst of darkness, they're not telling the truth. I don't care how uncomfortable it makes people feel. Oh, preacher, you make me feel bad, man. You make me feel uncomfortable because I don't feel comfortable talking about Jesus in public. Look, you just leave that up to the Lord because you don't want to force that anyway. You try to make that happen, you're going to mess it all up. But what you need to understand is you need the help of the Holy Ghost working and operating in your life so that the power of God and the truth of the gospel will come out of you, and that you would be a light in the midst of a perverse nation. The mass of this world, hey, God chose some out so that his light could shine through them so that others would know, hallelujah, that God is love, amen, and he wants to give that love to other people. That's the truth, and that's a big part of the truth. And if we leave it out, then we just got a little piece of the gospel. We don't have the whole gospel. The church is not just about social gatherings. The church is about Jesus being formed in us. The church is about Jesus being formed in us and the work of God being done and manifest through us. That's the way God provided the plan, and that is the plan of God. We also have the assurance that we will be presented to the Father that way in the end. Jude 1:24. Now on to Jude chapter 1. Well, there's only one chapter in Jude. Verse 24. Take a drink of water. Maybe it'll slow me down a little bit. Jude 1:24. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Well, that's a good word. Amen. I'm not saying you never fail, but I need you to know that God can keep you from falling.
Amen.
He can do it. Amen. If there's any failure on our part, it's our fault. It's not the word of God, and it's not God, it's the people of God. But hallelujah, the good news is that he's the one that can keep us from falling. Mm. And present us faultless. He will present us without spot. He will present us without blemish. He will present us without defect. Not because we never made a mistake, but because we're covered with the blemishlessness one. Amen. Before the presence of God, of his glory with exceeding joy. I don't know about you, but that makes me excited to know that God, the Son, will be able to present me without blemish before the Father. Hallelujah. Because of the fact that he paid the price. If I could just wrap my mind around that and learn to rest in that, I'm telling you right now, there's freedom in that. Hallelujah. There's freedom in that. Because now the enemy, he loses his grip. The enemy loses his grip because, see, the condemnation and guilt that's connected to the failure will hold you down. But I'm here to tell you right now that freedom and liberty comes with understanding and believing God in the truth. Amen. So number one, he chose us out to, and he allowed, that was a spiritual blessing, by the way, to be presented blameless before God. That was the first thing that I mentioned. But just overall, to become recipients of these spiritual blessings. The spiritual blessings that are available to us surround the fact that I believe we're in a spiritual battle. So it's not just about being presented blameless, but it's also about walking in victory. Ephesians chapter 6 in the same book that we're reading from speaks of that. I mean, I try to quote this a lot. My father-in-law always points out to me that I forget the rulers of darkness of this world. I don't do it on purpose. But nevertheless, Ephesians 6:12 says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Yeah. See, the enemy and his demonic forces are not only desiring to destroy God's plan on a corporate level. When I say corporate, I mean on a big scale. In other words, he wants God's word in some way to fail, and he wants to destroy God's plan on a large scale. But he also wants to destroy God's plan on an individual basis. As a matter of fact, that's where he attacks. He attacks at the individual level. He wants to attack you personally in your individual life. And the Father's plan was that once Jesus was ascended back to him, he would send the Spirit to us, to you and I, and use us as the body of Christ through which he would minister his love to a world that doesn't understand his love. Does that make sense? And so that's the plan. We've already discussed that already, that God has for mankind. So if he begins to attack us at the individual level, if you go to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, if he begins to attack Christians at the individual level across the globe, then it has an effect on the church. Now, we've been assured by the Lord himself that upon this rock, he told Simon Peter, upon this rock, what rock was that? He was talking about the revelation that my Father gave you that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God. Upon that rock, that foundation, amen, the church will be built. That's the foundation of the church. And the gates of hell won't prevail against it. We've been given the assurance by Jesus himself that the enemy of God and that the plans of hell are not going to overcome the plan of God and the body of Christ or the church that God has established, the institution that God has established upon this earth from which he directs his earthly battle against the forces of evil. The gates of hell are not going to prevail against it. Amen? At the same time, that doesn't mean that on an individual basis, there aren't battles that are taking place in individual lives and that it's not affecting the church body as a whole. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, it says, "From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth. Now, I got to tell you that just real quick. What he's talking about, compacted and fitly joined, he's talking about the fact, he's describing the body of Christ, you and I, the church, as body parts. Okay? Eyes, you know, whenever I do a neurological exam on a kid, I'm like, okay, follow my finger with your eyes only. Don't turn your head. I can't even do it. Don't turn your head. Just follow with my eyes, you know. And see, what you don't realize is that there's lateral and there's medial muscles and there's upper and there's lower muscles that are causing your eyes. Well, if you got a muscle on the right side of your eye that's not working right, your eye might be thrown off to the right. It's not fitly joined together. It's not working the way that it's supposed to. If you got a tendon that's torn in your finger, you can have a trigger finger and it's constantly flexed, right? You get the point that I'm trying. Your body parts aren't functioning properly. The Apostle Paul is using the individual believers and describing us as individual body parts. And if things aren't connected properly and aren't functioning properly, the whole body as a whole begins to suffer. And so I need you to understand that these spiritual blessings that God has given to those that have been chosen out in Christ are connected to the spiritual warfare that we engage. Now, I didn't write it down, but if you would go to Colossians 2:15, I want you to see, I love this scripture and I talk about it a lot, but I wanted you to see it. It says, "And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it." Can you go back to the verse before that? See that word "it" though? I want you see the word "it" right there. I'm pretty sure, I don't know, somebody told me I was wrong one time, but I'm pretty sure that's a direct object. And the direct object goes back to this right here. Cross. Yeah. That's what it's talking about. In it. The triumphing and the victory that Jesus won comes from the cross. He took the handwriting of ordinances, that's talking about the Old Testament law, that was against us. See, the law called you guilty. The law called me guilty because none of us in this room could keep the law.
Amen.
And it was contrary to us. It was against us. He took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross, and through that, he also, if you'll go back to verse 15, spoiled principalities and powers. That's talking about those fallen angels and demonic spirits. He spoiled them. He gained the victory over them. He made a show of them openly. He triumphed over them in it. See, that's why you can't go past the cross. It's the pivot point of your Christianity. It's the valve. Oh, if there was a valve on this thing right here. It's the valve right here that allows this. You opened it up. When you put your faith in what Jesus did for you at the cross, it opened up the valve and it allowed the Holy Spirit to begin to flow in the midst of your life. God has a plan, amen, that allows those that have been chosen out to be recipients of the power of God flowing in their lives, to be recipients of the victory of Jesus flowing in their lives, giving you victory, amen, so that you can accomplish the work of God as the body of God upon this earth. Amen. That was point number one, that we were chosen out. That's what makes you different, by the way. I know I say this sometimes a lot, but I think it's important that you understand that, because at night you're going to start thinking more highly of yourself than what you ought to. What makes you different than the world around you is the fact that you have been given the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit resides in you. You're not supposed to walk around like a peacock, like, yep, that's right, I got the Holy Ghost, and you don't. No. Now, when I first got saved, the reason I say that is because that's, I don't know why, maybe it's just because I got issues with pride and arrogance. I don't know. But I remember calling up my sister, I'm like, girl, you in a bind. I done got Jesus, and like, what in the world? Telling other people, you know, I don't know what I was thinking. Sometimes when you start hearing the truth of the gospel and you realize that a lot of the church doesn't even understand the gospel the way it's written, you start getting that way. I sat down with a bunch of Bible students one time. Robert was with me. We were eating at a Chinese restaurant. And that one kid, he wasn't even a Bible student. They called him Big Country because he was strong as an ox. And he sat there and he said, well, I think we all got a problem. And his point was, as soon as we start understanding the message of the cross, guess what? We get full of pride and arrogance. And we think that everybody else don't know nothing and we don't want to know anything.
Amen. Yeah.
And all them Bible students got kind of quiet because what he was saying was the truth.
Mm-hmm.
I knew he was saying the truth.
Yes,
I knew he was speaking to me.
Amen.
Because I've been there. And the reality of it is that whenever the heart of Jesus really begins to work in your life and in your heart, you begin to understand if it weren't for the grace of God.
Amen.
I wouldn't be a chosen out one.
Yes.
If it weren't for the grace of God, I wouldn't be a recipient of the spiritual blessings to understand the victory that Jesus won for me. Amen? And that it's a gift.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. And that other people have a right to it.
Yes.
It's, point number two, though, is this. It's sealed. If you could put up there Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. We talk about this verse quite a bit. It says, in whom you also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the word whom there is definitely speaking of Jesus, after you heard the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Next verse. Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. There were at least three things that I want to talk to you real quick that a seal represented in the ancient world when the Bible was written, even in the New Testament. I call it ancient because it was over 2,000 years ago. But before we get to that, we got to understand that Paul actually added another purpose to it. He gave a further understanding of it when he used that word earnest. That word earnest literally describes a down payment. The idea is that when you heard the gospel of Jesus Christ and you believed, when you put your faith in what God said, the initial act. See, this right here is a constant flow. This right here is a constant flow of grace, of spiritual blessings flowing in your life on a daily basis. Does that make sense? But in order for any of this to be able to take place on a daily basis, a first-time experience had to take place. Amen. Whenever that was that you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the valve was opened, and you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. The idea of a seal is like a stamp. You were stamped, and the purpose is for security or preservation. That's what the word sealed in the Greek literally means. It means to be stamped for security or for preservation. But the Apostle Paul added another concept to it. He wanted you and I to know your sealing or the stamping that God gave to you was an earnest or a down payment for you to understand that there's more that's on the way.
Oh, yeah.
This may not be the greatest illustration, but what I want you to know is if you can imagine somebody owed you $1,000. Has anybody ever owed you $1,000 before?
Yes.
I've had a few different people owe me some money. I had this one old boy, and you know, he asked me to borrow some money one time. And within a week, I said, you know what, dude? I said, I like you. I said, the problem is I've let people borrow money in the past. I said, I ain't no millionaire. I ain't got enough money to just be handing out to people and say, hey, don't worry about paying me back. You need to borrow some money. I'm going to let you borrow some money, but I expect you to pay the money back. He said, okay. Well, within 2 weeks, dude gave me $500. And he said, the rest is on the way. That's a good kind of illustration of what I'm trying to say. He meant business. He wanted me to know he meant business, that he was planning on paying me back. Amen. He didn't just say, I'm going to give you your money. He showed me up front, hey, here's the first installment. There's more to come. And sure enough, he paid off the rest of it. Now, the reason that a person would give you $500 down and couldn't come up with the rest is just because they didn't have the resources. That's not the case for God. God's got the resources.
Amen.
It's overflowing. I mean, it's up to the top and it's spilling over the top. It's because God planned it that way. He didn't want to give us everything up front. But whenever we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we receive the down payment, and we're sealed with the Holy Spirit of God, what ends up happening is that we know we've received the down payment, and we believe in our hearts that there's more to come. The more to come that Paul was talking about was the fact that Jesus is coming back one day. Jesus is coming back one day, and that this body that we still inhabit that's decaying and getting older each and every day, get a little bit more sore when you wake up in the morning, right? A couple more wrinkles, it's happening, you're getting older. But guess what? One day you're going to receive a glorified body. And the plan is going to be fulfilled. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Paul wants us to know, hey, hold on. Trust God. In the meantime, this is the down payment. Amen? And this is what's happening. What? See, part of that is Jesus told his disciples in John 15 and 15 that he said from now on, from henceforth, I call you not servants. For the servant knows not what his Lord does, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. The point that I'm just trying to make right there is this, is that God wants you and I to know that we're saved. God wants you and I to know that we're saved, and he wants you and I to know that he is coming back. And the way that he chose to do that is through sealing us with the Holy Spirit, giving us the Holy Spirit in our lives so that we would know that we're different now. Amen? Now let's talk real quick about those three things that this stamp did whenever it was used. First off, it was affixed to a document to guarantee that it was genuine. This down payment of the Holy Spirit that we receive makes us different than the world around us. I know that I talk about that a lot, but I just want you to be reminded that if you didn't have the Holy Spirit, you wouldn't be any different than the world around you. I said that earlier, right? I said that that's what makes you different is the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. If you're you're a chosen out one, you're one without blemish, the Holy Spirit has sealed you. It's a stamp that says, this thing right here is genuine. Now, I got to tell you, it proves your authenticity. Truthfully, if any of us in this place are honest with one another, we would admit that there's times that we don't look as authentic as what we ought to, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And I got to tell you that the world around you, when they see that, they're going to be like a crouching tiger ready to pounce on you.
Amen.
Even your own family members.
Amen.
They're just waiting. That's another thing that my mama used to tell me. I'm gonna call you out, mama. You know how to say it. She used to say, that's real Christian Matthew. Oh, man. I'm telling you, dude. That was like, my mama would know how to push my buttons, man. I mean, I would try not to say anything right then and there, but I was like, she just told me that. Good. Like, what you gonna say to your mom, right? She's probably right. My sarcastic attitude, my mouth, that's real Christian. Right? People are looking for an opportunity.
Amen.
To put that on you. But what I want to tell you is this. There's going to be times when you let the Lord down. The reality of it is that we're all a work in progress. And most of the times it's our personality that we have issues with. It's our personality and our lips. Because we don't really know how to talk to one another. We don't know how to talk to the people out there, right? So the wrong thing rubs me the wrong way. I can assure you, I've gotten a little bit better control over my tongue. Believe me, we ain't got it figured out. But my problem is facial expressions. I'll make facial expressions, and I know I'm doing it. I'm like rolling my eyes while I'm talking to somebody. Like, oh, Lord, here we go again. And I'm supposed to believe this. Or, you know, like, oh, please, you know, carry that down the road. I mean, my daddy was so tough and so rough that if you start complaining to me, I'm already rolling my eyes. I don't even want to hear it, dude, because we all going through it. I mean, I do want to hear it. God needs to change me. I want to be softer. I want to be able to listen. I really do. Not just because I know I'm supposed to. I know that because I know that the Lord is more mild and compassionate. Amen. At the same time, the Lord kept going. Amen. He didn't just quit halfway up the hill. Amen. The Apostle Paul didn't quit after he was shipwrecked the first time. You get what I'm saying? At some point in time, hallelujah, I believe that it will continue on. The Lord will teach us perseverance. Amen. He'll teach us endurance. He'll teach us some stick-to-itiveness. He'll teach us how to toughen up a little bit spiritually so that everything that happens to us doesn't hurt us so bad that we can't function tomorrow when we get up. There's something good about that. Amen? Praise God. I mean, look, somebody hurt you today or offend you today. I mean, what you going to do? You going to let it paralyze you to the point where you can't get up and keep on moving or you can't ever forgive anybody? That's not good. That's not healthy. You'll never accomplish anything for God if that happens. Anyway, I need you to know that when you mess up in front of the world, they're waiting for an opportunity to point out, that was real Christian of you. But at the same time, what I'll say is this, is that your sealing of the Holy Spirit, you know. They may not be able to see all the change. And listen to me, you might be looking for affirmation from people, but you're probably not going to always get it.
Amen.
Some people are good at encouraging. Some people are bad at encouraging. Some people are a little bit in the middle. Some people encourage too much. I don't know. But what I'm trying to say is this, is that you know if you've been sealed.
Amen.
You know if the Holy Spirit's doing a work in your life. You know that you're different than what you used to be. You know if the Holy Spirit wasn't working. Look, if the Holy Spirit wasn't in you, you'd be doing the same old stuff that you used to do.
Amen.
And I mean, keep on doing it repeatedly and not even think twice about it. No, the Holy Spirit lives in you. You're different than what you used to be. Amen? You've been sealed. It's saying that you're genuine. Number two, it was attached to certain goods while they were in transit to show ownership and ensure protection. So I'd imagine if you went down into the bow of an ancient ship and you looked at the cargo that was in there, many times it'd have a stamp on it that said who it belonged to, so that there was no confusion, that when it was going from point A to point B, it would meet its proper destination. It would be protected against, you know, thievery or just accidental people taking over. What I need you to know this morning is that you are precious cargo. You're precious cargo in transit from point A to point B. You're in transit on the journey, the pilgrimage of Christianity. God has a purpose and a plan for your life, and He stamped you, and He will preserve you, amen. But I need you to know that doesn't mean that nothing bad will ever happen. The point that I'm trying to make is that God wants to ensure our protection, amen. He wants to preserve us in our journey, not just to save you from getting your identity stolen if you're careless, because that's not what God's about, but to preserve your life, to preserve you, amen, until the end of the journey, so that God can accomplish what He desires to accomplish in your life. The number three thing was this. It represented a designation of office in the state of service. What does that mean? It's kind of like the U.S. president's seal. Whenever you see the seal, it means that this is business from the president. When you would see the stamp, it meant that this was business from whoever was conducting business. It's almost like doing business as. We're the Crossway Inc. doing business as the Crossway Ministry. The Word of God says in Romans 8:29, it says this, "For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." The stamp of God on our lives is part of the process where we're sealed with the Holy Spirit, and is the conforming into the image of Christ. In a certain sense, we are the image of God upon this earth. I don't want to go too far with that, because I'm not talking about what the Catholic Church says about the Pope. They say he's the vicar of Christ, meaning he is Christ on the earth. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we are doing business for God. God, we are the body of Christ, and God is working in us and through us as He conforms us into the image of His dear Son. He's making us look more like Jesus in the midst of a lost and a dying world. And as the Holy Spirit molds and shapes us into the image of Jesus, God is using us once again on this journey to do His business, and we represent Him on this earth. This brings me to my last point, crafted. If you could turn to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." The idea is that it's not that the works that you can do that saved you, but God saved you to do works through you. Amen. Yeah. You're His workmanship. Yes. That's why I use the word crafted. It's what it means is workmanship. It means a product that has been crafted or produced. God is producing a product in you and in your life. Before we were saved, we couldn't be prepared to do any kind of work for God. We were so caught up and focused on ourselves, so focused on our own circumstances, so focused on our own lives. If things didn't go our way, God couldn't do no work in our life like that. We were just caught up in ourselves. But now we're in a process. We're being formed. We're being conformed. We're being molded. We're being produced into a product, amen, that God can use. Listen, God's grace through the Holy Spirit, He doesn't waste anything. He takes good times, bad times. He takes laughter, tears. He uses all that and mixes it with the Holy Spirit in our lives. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, He makes something new, preparing us to do the work that He's created for us to do. He wants us to be a light in the midst of darkness and to bring hope to hopeless people. And now that all these concepts are considered that we've talked about this morning, we need to go and close back in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father." Remember, I wanted you to pay attention to "blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. That word blessed right there is the word eulogitas. Eulogitas. It's where we get our word eulogy. I think I've mentioned this before. The word eulogy is oftentimes used when it's describing something that's done at a funeral, but it's not just for funerals. It's whenever you say good words about somebody, you know? It's oftentimes considered, once again, whenever someone's been deceased, but any kind of eulogy is when you say good words about somebody. Essentially, it means to praise. That's why I titled this morning's message, Give Him Praise, because that's what Paul's doing. God be blessed is what he's saying. God be blessed. Why? Because blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Because when you start to give it a revelation of all that the Father has done, seeing in advance that there would be this mass of humanity that required spiritual blessings, seeing in advance that there would be this mass of humanity that needed a plan of redemption to be purchased back through the shedding of blood, seeing in advance that he would pour upon them spiritual blessings, he would choose them out in Christ, and that he would prepare them and craft them and mold them into a part of his body and allow them to be used by him in the work of God so that others might hear the good news and then ultimately to be a child of God and to spend eternity with him. Praise God. Hallelujah. Something ought to come over us on the inside of us when we begin to realize, after I've been sealed with the Holy Spirit of God, knowing that a down payment has been given, knowing that there's more that lies ahead on the horizon, and in the meantime, he's going to allow me to be used by him. He's worthy of praise. What Paul's trying to say is that if you get it, you're going to get it. If you start to get it, that what God has done in you, and you start to feel it on the inside of you, you start to allow him to use you, you're going to get it. He's worthy of praise. Now, I can't tell you that every day you're going to have as much pep in your step as what you ought to. I can't tell you you're just going to be hopping around and happy all the time. I tend to be a guy that's, glass half full instead of half empty. But at the same time, sometimes days are a little more dreary than others. Sometimes things are a little bit more sad than other times. But what I'm trying to say is that overall, God is good. Amen. God is good, and he's got a good plan. Amen. And he wants to use us in that plan. Praise God.